It is Saturday night. Welcome to the Jonathan Ross Show. Did you see that amazing jump by the Austrian skydiver? Did anyone see that?
Yeah.
That was incredible. He was 24 miles up when he jumped. His name was Felix Baumgartner. He broke the record for the highest free fall, the longest jump, and the longest pronunciation of the word wee. He also broke the world record for the amount of times he had to say to someone, no, not Baumgartner, it's pronounced Baumgartner. the world's oldest dad has been announced. He is 96 years old. Here he is. Have a look at that picture. There he is. His little miracle there. When I first saw that picture, I thought Strictly Come Dancing are working Johnny Ball too hard. Look at him. But a new life at that age, how lovely, the joy. And you can see in this next picture the joy it's bringing him. You can see there. I think every new father recognises the look on his face there. Those are the eyes of a man who wishes he was down the pub with his mates watching Sky Sports. do any of you here use fake tan? I think, from where I'm standing, quite a few more than ordinary. In that case, has this ever happened to any of you? You start putting the fake tan on and then you run out before you finish, like this guy did. You haven't doctored that photograph in any way. He looks like he's run out of Ron Seal and Wicks was closed, isn't it? I think the mistake he made, though, really, is he should have started at the top and worked his way down. Because then if he ran out, he could have gone out with long socks on. A man has been convicted after making 6,000 nuisance calls to emergency services, saying he'd got his manhood caught in various household objects, including a jam jar. Now, I know what you're thinking. That was either a very narrow jam jar or some very sticky jam. He also claimed he got his penis stuck in a Hoover. And he was finally convicted when evidence was given by this witness who wishes to remain nameless. Felix Baumgartner wasn't the only Austrian thrill seeker looking to amaze the world this week. There's another Austrian fellow ran into, had a very close shave indeed when he went for the greatest dive of all time. I love this clip. Look at this.
Warte, ich filme das Wasser, warte. Eis hier überall. Ja,
sogar überall rein.
In der Mitte am besten da.
Ja. Ich will nicht mal gucken, nicht als Lache, das zu hart ist.
Nicht drauf?
Ja.
Mother and my new band is called Siskill.
That's pretty good, isn't it? Hey, we've got a great show for you this evening, including fabulous music from Emily Sunday, ladies and gentlemen. There she is. Let's see you also on the programme tonight. My first guest is one of the hottest stars in Hollywood. It's only Bradley Cooper, ladies and gentlemen. There he is. Bradley, how you doing?
Great.
Good to see you here. Hey, I hope you don't mind me saying this, Bradley. Why would you mind? Because Bradley was recently voted the sexiest man alive. Ladies, is there any doubt that you are looking at the most attractive man on the planet right now?
Without a doubt.
Okay. And now, what do you think about Bradley? Bradley Cooper, ladies and gentlemen, he'll be out in just a minute, chatting away. My next guest is a writer, actor, a brilliant comedian. It's the very funny Mr. David Mitchell. Good to have you here, David. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
David, is it true that you don't like it when people, if you're out about, you don't like people commenting on your clothes or your appearance when they recognise you?
Well, it's, that makes me sound like I'm a sort of megalomaniac and saying, don't look at me. No, I like my appearance to be entirely neutral. Like, no one would notice it positively or negatively. I think all humans should have uniforms, like in the former communist states of the Eastern Bloc.
That's why we sat you next to Bradley, because no one's going to be looking at you anyway, so you're safe for now. David Mitchell, ladies and gentlemen, I'm thrilled he's here. He's a brilliant guest. OK, and next up, we have genuine rock gods. From Aerosmith, it's Steven Tyler and Joe Perry. the Toxic Twins, as they were once known. You know what? seeing them there, and they're very handsome, and I would consider them sexually attractive men. I think I should clear up the fact that although Bradley Cooper is officially the sexiest man alive, that's only because, according to medical science, Stephen Joe should actually be dead. Otherwise, they'd be top of the list there. Stephen Tyler and Joe Perry, ladies and gentlemen, that's our this week's show for you. Okay. Just before we get to the guest, let me just show you this, because I thought this was one of the creepiest things I've seen for quite a long while. It's a man who's collected, he collects this, this is his hobby, and he's managed to collect 600 Cabbage Patch Kids. Okay, here he is at home enjoying. Okay. Surprisingly, before you ask, ladies, he is still single. he's enjoying that a little bit too much, isn't he? But I thought that was a bit weird. But then when we mentioned we were going to show this and we asked for permission from the Cabbage Patch people, they sent me this in. They sent in this Cabbage Patch doll they'd made for us, which is a Cabbage Patch version of me. But, you know, there was... It doesn't actually look that much like me, I don't think, but there was a stage in the 90s when I actually did look a lot like this. I don't know if you remember when I was on the TV show, They Think It's All Over. Here's a shot of us there, a publicity shot we had. And you can see... let's get my first guest out. He's one of the biggest stars in Hollywood right now. Here he is in the huge hit movie, The Hangover.
Phil, do not go in the bathroom.
Yeah, will you put on some pants?
Phil, there is a tiger in the bathroom.
What's going on?
There's a jungle cat in the bathroom!
Okay, okay. I'll check it out.
Don't go in, don't go in. Be careful, don't.
Oh, hey. He's not kidding, there's a tiger in there.
I'm very excited he's here. It's Mr. Bradley Cooper, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, Bradley. Thank you for joining me. Come and have a seat. Great to have you here.
Thank you. This is nice.
Well, thank you. It's it's designed for your comfort. Well, this sounds a bit crazy to me. You just flew in to be with us from Las Vegas today.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. But we're going to Las Vegas. We were in Los Angeles yesterday working it. We just wrapped.
And this is, we should say, this is exciting. As this is
Hangover Part 3.
So those guys at this, they've still got a hangover.
They are. They all do. Yeah,
that
yeah.
That was some party they had. there have been rumours here in the press. I don't know if you've read this. I don't know if you even know who this young woman is. But there's been rumours over here that Cheryl Cole, who we all love in this country, is going to be making guest appearance in Hangover.
Yeah, I don't know if that's accurate or not. No, yeah, no. I'm not sure if that.
Well, you're making
true.
The movie, so if you don't know, then I think.
But you know what? We don't know everything. We get there's surprises all the time.
So maybe she could be hidden in a bathroom like that tiger.
That would be nice. Okay.
So did you know? you knew, I guess, when you were making one that you'd be working with Mike Tyson.
I did, yes. Okay,
that must be, I would have thought, initially at least, an intimidating day at work.
Especially for Zach, who plays Alan, who Mike had to hit. Yeah. He was not looking forward to that day. Mike, he's a great guy, and he was in Hangover Part 2 as well, and I was so happy to meet him.
He didn't actually make contact with Zach.
You know what? To be honest, I remember because I was right there. And they take stills when you're shooting a movie, and he hit him so fast or went by, and Zach has a big beard, and actually his beard was indented when he did it. But there's a still of the shot, and he's already followed through, and Ed and I haven't even turned yet. That's how quickly he hit him. Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
Yeah, terrifying. I
yeah,
imagine.
Could have been the end for Zach.
All right, now Bradley is a very talented actor, and he's obviously quite easy on the eye. This is a man like me. You will find this very, very irritating indeed. He's also an excellent cook, I believe.
I love to cook, but I grew up. I'm a half Italian, and my grandmother, you know, growing up, that was just all Italians talk about is, you know, what you're going to eat for breakfast, and then when you're eating breakfast, what are you going to eat for lunch, and you know, and then it goes on and on.
But you used to work as a cook as well.
I did. I worked at restaurants since I was 15. I was like a busboy, and then worked in the back of the house, and yeah, all the way up till I was in my early 20s.
So in magnificent shape, acts, has sparkling eyes, cooks, and also you speak fluent French.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
So irritating.
No, I have some horrible traits.
Well, okay, well, what do you have? Humanize yourself for me. Make us men feel better about ourselves. What are your bad habits?
The hardest thing to stop was chewing tobacco. I used to always chew tobacco.
Well, that's a disgusting
habit. That's disgusting, yeah. Okay. And I would do it at work, too. Ooh. I remember shooting this movie, I can't believe I did this, but they called He's Just Not That Into You. And I remember being there, I had scenes with Scarlett Johansson, who's a beautiful, talented actress, and oh my God, it's Scarlett Johansson, and I can't believe I have this job, and hold on a second. And I'm thinking of this, and I just have a cup, and I don't even think about it. I just have this big wad of dip in my mouth, and we're talking about the scene, and I'm like spitting, and I remember there was like saliva, would be like a line of saliva to the cup, and it was really disgusting, yeah. Okay. And she would, and here's the other stupid thing, like deep down I thought like, yeah, but you really like it. Like, you really, it's, come on, it looks like I'm a man.
You feel he's manly. And it kind of is.
Let me tell you something, Bradley. No, it's disgusting.
Well, let me just check. Wait a minute, does that put you off, Bradley?
No.
Yeah, you're saying that's so annoying. David, have you ever chewed tobacco?
No. No. I think I should try it, though, because I don't think I come across as manly enough.
Stephen and Joe, I imagine you have tried most things. Did you ever do the tobacco chewing?
Positive, and we did everything.
Okay, so Bradley has a new movie coming out very soon here. It's coming out on the 21st of November. I think it's the best movie you've ever made.
Oh, thanks.
And
yeah,
I've liked many of your movies, many fine films. It's called Silver Linings Playbook. And this is, I imagine, a pretty important film for you.
You know, it was, honestly, it was life-changing. I mean, it was when I was a kid dreaming about being in movies, and it was movies like this. And David O. Russell is you know, one of the best American directors that we have, and Robert De Niro's in it, and Jennifer Lawrence, and Chris Tucker, and it's just a great story that takes place in Philly, and I'm from Philly, and, you know, I played De Niro's son. It was incredible.
So your first day working with Robert De Niro, how does that play out for you? What do you do?
You know, it was an interesting culmination, because the first time I ever met him was, well, I never met him, but I was in the audience, and he was in doing Inside the Actor's Studio, and I asked him a question, and...
So how old were you then?
I was, 26 or something.
So you hadn't had any real success that we would know?
No, I was still in school.
Okay.
Yeah, and I asked him a question. I remember he said, because he doesn't talk much. Yeah. And he had done the whole interview, and I remember I asked him I was so nervous. This is stupid. I was so nervous because it was such a specific question I asked him. it was such like a nerdy question about this movie Awakenings, where he wanted to go for a walk, his character, and this medicine he was taking wasn't working anymore, so he kept having a tick, and he would compensate by pretending to rub his eyebrow. And so I wanted to ask him if that was something that he saw or just came up, and I was just like, I was shaking. Because you had to stand up and ask the question and say your name and what track you're on, which is so stupid, so I never even said that. But anyway, so this other guy asked a question, and I said, I ask it, and then he's there, and he's like, no, I didn't see anybody do that, no. That's a good question. And I was like, what? Wow. And it was like a beam of light shot into my stomach when he said that. And this is so... And then I asked the school if I could have a copy of that moment. And they just had it like in the wide shot. And I'm not kidding. I would think about it like for a year later, I would think like, well, you know what? Like, go for it. Because Robert De Niro did say that was a good question. And honestly, it was... Yeah, so.
Just that tiny bit of
advice. You never know the impact you have.
So Jennifer Lawrence in this film, the two of you are great together. It's very funny, the scenes between the years, and it kind of culminates in a big... There's an important thing, it builds up. I don't want to give too much away, but it's a very important dance sequence.
Yes, yeah.
At the end. And, and it's not quite what you expect it to be, and it's funny as well as being kind of important. But presumably you guys had to work pretty hard at that.
Yeah, I mean, anytime you want to become intimate and get to know somebody very fast, you put them in a situation where you're going to be vulnerable and, you know, in the first second. And I never met Jennifer before, and I got that role very late. And so I drove from one set to another, and I showed up, and next thing you know, I'm in this small studio that was really, there was no air conditioning, and I have like, a, you know, like a dance clothes on, and then there's this beautiful woman who I hadn't seen Hunger Games or anything, and I didn't know her, I just spoke to her on the phone, who was so present, and next thing you know, I'm like, she has to put her hands under my sweaty armpits, and we're this close, and having to learn to dance, and but it actually worked out perfectly, because I think it really made us able to just, you know, lose everything and just be sort of present with each other.
We have the trailer show. It was 21st of November. I loved it, and it really wasn't what I expected. I mean, I didn't know what I expected.
Right.
But it was funny, and it was sad, and it was exciting, and at heart of it, there's a really lovely romance. Have a look at this.
I don't know where I belong.
Hey!
What the hell?
I just want us to be friends.
So how did you lose your job?
By having sex with everybody in the office.
Everybody?
I was very depressed after Tommy died.
We don't have to talk about it.
Thanks.
How many were there?
Don't let Tiffany get you in trouble. She's my friend. Why would you say that?
The
there's this dance thing.
I can only do it if I have a partner.
Oh, I'm not gonna dance with you.
So is this the girl you wrote about?
You wrote about me?
She's fine.
She is my friend with an F.
A capital F.
For a friend.
Let me tell you, you gotta pay attention to the signs. When life reaches out with a moment like this, it's a sin if you don't reach back. I'm telling you, it's a sin if you don't reach back.
There we go. Silver lining playbook, isn't it? And, well, we saw just about everyone in there, of course, with De Niro. And it's kind of quite a rough scene between the two of you. You have a kind of argy-bargy scene going on there.
Yeah, I mean, I shouldn't tell the story. I'll try to tell the story.
No, tell the whole story. You can't laugh at something and keep it quiet.
Anyway, next question. Yeah. But we had to do this scene, and at this point, we've done two movies together, and I really love him to death and feel totally comfortable with him, and it was one of the reasons why I felt so secure initially, because I was like, oh, at least Bob's there, and we had to do this scene in the attic. A very emotional scene. I mean, like crazy. Like my character's flipping out, and we could start hitting each other. But, you know, my character sort of is very much like his father. And you know, like those very light, those thin pajamas you wear? You know, they're almost like a pimp outfit, you know, when you go...
Oh, like a satiny kind of...
Yeah. So Dad had that on, and also I had that on. And then at one point, he's on top of me in the bed hitting me, right? And I'm like this, and he's on top of me.
And you got no action.
No, Grant. No. But if I did, it would have been all over. But there's no underwear. There's just literally like a half a centimeter of silk in between his
the tension.
And then he would do the take, and he'd be like, "Is that good? We got it good?" And I was just trying not to laugh because Robert De Niro, you know, you feel that, you know, is the thing. I just thought, how has this happened?
Wow.
At 36 years old, I'm Robert De Niro.
I'm rubbing balls with the greatest screen actor.
Well, David Mitchell has a book out. I hope it's packed with anecdotes as rich as that one, David.
It's got an identical anecdote.
That's his move. That's De Niro's move.
Hey, I need to ask you this. Now, you will have seen Bradley. Bradley, you kind of do modelling work as well, don't you?
No.
Yes, you do. What's going on here?
That's horrible.
What are these? A holiday
snaps? These are me and my...
What's that?
My,
is that your Twitter profile? What is it?
These are me and my pals.
What's going on there? What's going on there?
Me and my pals hanging out.
You know, if anybody...
Don't you do that with your buddies? You pick some prime ones.
If we could pan round, you see De Niro in silk pajamas taking over. We done yet? That's a sexy photograph.
You think so? I think it's awful.
When you're doing that picture, is there a sexy place in your head you go to, Bradley? Where do you go when you're taking these pictures, Bradley?
The truth is, I love everything I do, and like acting and being in promoted movie. I absolutely fucking hate taking a photo, having that done.
Well, so you look like you're hating every second of that.
I think that was me just sort of... cringing that I'd somehow taken my shirt off.
Well, is it embarrassing to do that? I mean, it's not as embarrassing as the virus to take my shirt off, but I mean, you feel like you're being sort of sold in the wrong way?
No, I just don't feel comfortable doing it. I just don't, for some reason, I never...
So you wouldn't want to take it off now?
Oh, God, no. Believe me, you don't want to see it.
It's been lovely having you here. You're a charming company.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Really lovely, and I know you're slightly jet-lagged, and you come in and you've found the energy to entertain us all. And also, congratulations on Silver Linings Playbook.
Oh,
really,
thank you.
I think it's gonna win awards, and I hope it wins a major one for you as well, because it's terrific. It's out November 21st. Go and see it. You won't regret it. Mr. Bradley Cooper, ladies and gentlemen. Don't go away. After the break, I'll be joined by our very own heartthrob, Mr. David Mitchell. Welcome back to the show. Let's get my next guest out. He's one half of the terrific Peep Show, a very funny comedian in his own right. It's Mr. David Mitchell. David, how lovely to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. David Mitchell, well, first of all, it's great to see you. It's great to have you on the show. And the thing earlier when I mentioned about you not liking being recognised, is that the story behind the beard? Is that why you've grown this beard, or is it...?
Well, the main reason I grew this beard is that I'd never had a proper go on my face before. Mm. You know, it does a thing, and I'd never let it do the thing.
So just to see what your body could do?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Nothing, you know, I just strained every part of me, and hair came out of my face. But nothing else happened.
But you're shaping it a little bit. You're trimming some of the cheek area, I imagine?
I'm not trimming it. No, this is a sign of good character. It naturally grows neatly.
Okay, David has a book out, and it's a very, genuinely, it's a very funny read. David Mitchell backstory. And you might think that was about just his life, but there is a very specific reason why it's called Backstory, of course.
Well, yes, it is, because it's a memoir. It's got, hopefully, it's got jokes in it.
Yes.
Definitely got attempts at humour in it. But also, it's a self-help guide, because I had a very bad back for a long time. And thank you. People, I often get, that was an R, wasn't it?
Yeah, a little bit.
And so the thing that sorted my back out is I walk for an hour every day, and that's totally sorted my back out. And so contained within that book are not only jokes, but the fact that I've just said, so actually there's no need to buy the book.
Well, no, because there's a lot of, but it also, what's clever about it, I think, is that it is very much, it's written around these walks, or around one walk. It kind of takes you on an actual kind of almost a literal journey through London as you walk to fix your Mac.
Yes, indeed. A literal journey and a metaphorical journey from, if you can imagine, I've come all the way from Salisbury in 1974 to London in 2012, which, you know, it's an incredibly long journey.
But I thought, this is not me judging you, but my first impression of you, that you were probably a really, really, really weird child. And yet, but now when you read the book, you realise you were quite a sweet, you were quite a normal little child.
Oh, do you think so?
Yes, I mean,
when I was a child, one of the things that I was oppressed by was the thought that I was a weird child. and I wanted to be more normal. And I was sort of into, you know, dressing up as people and pretending to be various incarnations of Time Lords or 18th century kings.
You just look like a very sweet little boy there. You're not. Are you wearing knickerbockers there? I'm not sure.
What I've done there, in a way that I'm glad to hear you don't think is weird, is I've tucked my trousers into my socks so I look more like I'm wearing those sort of 18th century trousers and stockings that I'd seen depicted on television and I thought to be quite the thing.
Was this you, because this is in the book, you wanted to be, or you liked the idea of being a king?
That was, I loved pretending to be various authority figures in my own sort of mental universe, and that was the game I liked playing. I didn't like playing with Lego much, I didn't like playing football much. I liked sort of imagining I was a king and I'd be giving orders to courtiers and starting wars and that sort of thing. And other times I liked to imagine I was the captain of a spaceship. You know, I used to watch Star Trek a lot, and I'd sort of join in with Star Trek, so that if, you know, Captain Kirk said something, I'd go, yeah, that's a very good idea, but I think maybe we should approach it differently. And I cast myself as Captain Kirk's boss.
Let me ask you about the bell you had with which you summoned orange juice.
You sound like Orange Juice was the name of my dog. No, there was a time at my grandparents' house. This was humiliatingly revealed on Would I Lie to You, by the way, when I had a little bell that I'd ring. Because they had a bell anyway, they didn't buy me the bell. The bell existed in the house, and I took to ringing the bell, and my grandparents would then bring me some orange squash.
Had you prearranged this with your grandparents, or did they just guess, well, he's ringing the bell, he must want something, and they reached for orange juice?
I think it was sort of prearranged.
It was mutual.
And I think, yeah. I don't think it went on for a long time. I'm so... Well, I was such a fool to let this story get out.
Well, how did it end, then? Did they one day stop bringing you the juice when the bell was rung, or did it just...
They're dead now.
Oh, don't end the story that way.
I don't think they died of exhaustion from bringing the orange juice, but...
Did you have to? The thing when I'm reading books, famous people have written, and it mentions other people, I often wonder, do you go to the trouble of running the stories past those other names? Did you check that it was okay? For example, your partner Robert Webb, when I say partner, I mean comedy partner, obviously. Did you go past the stories in there with him first, or is this a surprise to him?
No, I didn't. I didn't run any stories past him. But I'm sort of nice about him. I think I like him, so I'm meant to be nice about him. If I've not been nice about him, I actually lack the skills with which to express my liking.
Here's exciting news. David's back quite soon, I'm not quite sure when, with a new series of Peep Show. I think it's November, is it?
Yeah, next month. Yeah.
I'm so excited about this. Because there was a period when it looked like they would not be making any more. And I remember talking to you once and you thought maybe it had come to the end.
Yeah, I think they have that. We have that period after almost every series that's gone out. Because I think people who watch it really like it. Yeah. But a lot of people don't watch it, which, you know.
We have a preview. No one's seen any of the footage yet, I believe, from the forthcoming series.
I don't think I've seen this.
Well, we have a clip. So, we have a clip. Yeah. This is David Exton, the new series of Peep Show. It'll be with you on Channel 4 in November. Look at this.
It's a lot of shopping, Jez.
Yeah, stocking up.
Right. It's just Dobby might well have moved in before we eat all these horrible lentils.
Yeah, I've just got the feeling maybe I'm going to get to finish these lentils.
She is moving in, you know. I'm getting a firm date. Why have you got cat food?
To confuse them. Fucking nectar inspectors. That's why I got the denture cleaner, to throw them a weird one. Who are these guys?
Great, so now they'll think we're a couple of guys with our booze and our pizzas and a cat we starve and an old man we've kidnapped whose dentures we periodically deign to cleanse.
Mm-hmm. A laughing chat. That'll be in November. Yeah, it's a very funny book. I'm very much enjoying it. And it kind of has a very happy ending as well.
Yes, it does have
it's
a happy
actually
ending.
Very yeah. incredibly romantic. I mean, incredibly romantic, really touchingly romantic, because towards the end of the book, perhaps it's your story, towards the end of the book, David meets a new person who may one day bring him orange juice. Could we... but it is, you speak very openly about your love for the woman you're about to marry, Victoria Collins.
Yes. Well, it's sort of... I'm sort of weird and embarrassed and repressed talking about it, but it was... it was an amazing thing to meet her. I've not had many successful relationships in my life, you'd be amazed to learn. And so I thought that would probably be a state of affairs that would continue and I could console myself with the trappings of panel show stardom, you know, the green room at Mock the Week, that sort of thing. But so it was really, you know, it was more than, considerably more than I felt I deserved to meet her and just sort of literally fall in love within about... within about 20 minutes.
Wow. But then you found out that she was not available.
Yeah, then she went out with someone else for about 3 years, which was a bit of a hitch. Yeah. But now it's worked out and we're getting married.
Wow.
So,
how lovely is that? It's the loveliest section to read. Yeah. Just before we say goodbye for now, I was at someone's house a short while ago and David was there as a guest as well. And at the end of the evening, and this shows you what kind of rock and roll lifestyles we lead, a table tennis table was produced and we played some table tennis. And you would think to look at David that he's not a very sporty man. And yet he beat everyone in the place very comfortably at table tennis. You're like a table tennis progeny. You're like Forrest Gump or something. I mean, you play table tennis fiercely and with a determination.
I think what you mean is I'm slightly better than you are.
Well, you did beat me comfortably. Is this a skill you've always had?
I've always quite liked table tennis. Actually, that's actually one of the secrets that isn't in the book. I'm all right at table tennis. It's better than pool, isn't it?
Well, we have a table tennis table here this evening. I don't know, Bradley, are you any good with the table tennis?
No, but I'll give it a try.
Okay, Steve, Joe, you any good with the table tennis?
Oh yeah.
Sounds to me like there's a rock god challenge waiting for you. Right there at the end of the show. So at the end of the show, we have time. I'm going to get the table tennis table out. Please, no gambling. It's just for fun. And we'll see how good David really is.
Okay.
David, and then...
Now I'm scared. I had a dream about playing Aerosmith at table tennis.
ladies and gentlemen, the fabulous Mr. David Mitchell. Okay, we're going to take another break. Don't go away. I'll be joined by two genuine rock gods, Aerosmith, Steven Tyler and Joe Perry, right here after the break. Welcome back. My next guest, a legend with a capital L. And if you doubt that, take a look at this. Walk this way. Steven Tyler and Joe Perry, ladies and gentlemen, come on out, fellas. Nice angle from there. Oh, ha, ha. Joe's cool. He's looking out, taking his time. Taking his time. Joe, come and sit down. Have a seat. Relax. Well, I'm excited you're here. I'm a big Aerosmith fan.
Oh, beautiful. What's your favorite song?
I like all your songs, and I love your roller coaster as well. You know there's an Aerosmith roller coaster? Did you know that? So, exciting news for Aerosmith fans. New album is out November the 5th. First album for, is it 10 years?
10 years.
Why so long for a new
album? Well, it hasn't really taken that long. It's just we've been busy getting ready.
So you've been off doing other things as well, I guess.
Oh, yeah, touring.
And we've been looking at it more like it's taken 40 years to get here.
So that's how long you guys have been together for then, I guess. What year was it? How old were you when you first met each other?
Well, we don't remember that date. We were swimming in the...
No.
I don't know. 71.
18, 19 years old, maybe.
And you were both in different bands, weren't you, initially?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I was busy eating New York, and he was up in New Hampshire.
Yeah.
And what was it about each other's music or style that made you think, okay, this is going to what we should get together?
Well, you know, I heard his bands after I'd given up on all of mine. And my father played classical music, went to Juilliard. So when I heard him rocking out, I thought, you know, it's like the chocolate and peanut butter to make the Reese's.
Yeah. Yeah. He had a schooled approach to things and knew how to keep things in tune, you know, relatively, you know, keep things on the beat and everything. And I was more like, I just want to turn it up, play loud, and have fun. And that was it. And so the two of us together, it kind of, just like you said, it so just...
Kind of the discipline and the anarchy kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
My better half.
But you guys, I mean, you've been very close all this time, and you've also had terrific fallings out, haven't you?
Well, yeah.
Right, you know what? If it wasn't for the cracks, there'd be nowhere for the light and sun to shine through. You think?
It's a nice way to put it.
Is that getting off from you? No, of course we've been at each other. You know, it's... You know, 40 years with guys, it's bad enough with women. Now, hold on. Hold on.
The last falling out, I guess, would this be fair to say, was when you accepted the job as one of the judges on American Idol, but didn't think to pick up a phone and tell one of your oldest friends?
No, that's not it at all. They were just jealous I was sitting next to J-Lo. He had a big crush on me.
No, I don't think so. No, I think it was more what you said. It was that. Yeah. That's pretty much it. Actually, I was happy for you, you know, because it was a perfect thing. You got to, you know, dump out all your one-liners and stuff. It was a great job for you.
And not put them into the songs for us, huh?
Well, that part of it, no, I never thought it took away from...
Half of them are in our songs.
You know, I don't want to start an argument again.
We're not fighting.
Yeah, okay.
No, this is normal.
Okay, but you weren't told, were you? You found out the way everyone did. You found out on the internet.
Yeah. Or however, you know, I mean, I don't know, I read it somewhere.
And 2 months prior to that, they were looking for another lead singer, so I figured I'd fix them good, right?
Really? Were you?
Well,
I love this show.
After I read in the paper that he was trying out for Led Zeppelin.
Okay, I see what's happening here, because you're saying, well, I did this bad thing because you did this. And he's saying, yeah, but I did this because you did this. So what did he do before that made you think you might want to join Led Zeppelin? This just goes back.
It goes back a long way. 42 years.
Take it back. Let's see if we can get to a first girlfriend. In fact,
I was just thinking about that today. Because there is a connection there.
Positively, see this? How epiphanous.
So who stole whose first girlfriend from the other?
Well, why don't we get this out now?
We were in an apartment building and we all lived together for once, and I thought that was a secret to make it.
Yeah.
That was a secret. Band being together, wake up in the morning and write songs. Yeah. And we did, and I looked at Joe and I said, wow, man, we're together finally, we're all living here. And he moved out in 2 weeks with his girlfriend. And I've never forgiven him.
The girl was part of his past.
Oh, I see. Let's so you, his way. Old girlfriend.
Well, I don't know. You never really girlfriend.
I never really told you what happened with that.
Well, no. You know what? I don't really care. Don't matter.
It came out in a song called Love in an Elevator.
Okay.
No, it was actually I Don't Want to Kiss Your Thing.
Let's talk a little bit about the many years of partying and drug use. Because you were kind of pretty famous for that as well. I mean, fortunately, the music was always the big thing, but...
Well, I mean, it was part in time. Remember, we grew up in the 70s, and the war was on, and it was like, make love, not war, and it was very apropos. It was the thing to do. We just took it to the excesses, you know.
When we talk about excesses, though, what kind of excesses are we talking about? Did you ever do drugs before a show, during a show?
Uh-huh. During a show, yeah. Of course.
Of course, during the show.
I think it's suffice to say we snorted up half of Peru, so... you know, I'm proud of it, not proud of it. You know, it took me down.
Yeah.
But it also got us through. The only way out is through. By 1979, we played every state in America, including the state of Oblivion, 9 times.
When you were doing the drugs on stage, were we talking about cocaine on stage? Is that what we're talking about, or other substances?
You know, lots of Jack Daniels.
Well, that was, Jesus, a long time ago. You know what I mean?
But where would you do it on stage? Because you couldn't do it in front of the audience.
Well, right in back, there's space.
Well, did you have a room, or what did you have, like a tent there. You went into? Yeah. A little cocaine tent, or a little hut? Or a TARDIS? Where did you do... Where, was it laid out for you by someone else?
Or? Yes, if you really want to get specific, so the way we did it was you'd take a cup, paper cup, and put a straw in it, put your whatever it was, and you would turn around and pretend to have a sip of whatever was in the cup. And,
but you'd actually be snorting...
you just had to just miss your mouth by about this much. And, you know.
Wow. And
let's talk about ping pong.
Are you bored of talking about dogs?
Yeah, we don't want to talk about
that.
But
you can see why it's fascinating to those of us who haven't been through life to that excess, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Well, when you live on stage and you're used to moments where the curtain's dropping at Madison Square, you're not going to go back and play ping pong, even though we grew up doing that. So we're going to whump your ass, okay?
Well, don't look at me. I'm not saying I'm a ping pong expert. I'm saying Mitchell has got the fearsome skills.
Has he got the balls?
He has got the balls. Okay, we're going to take a break. We're going to be talking to Joe and Steve and more after this, and we're going to have that table tennis showdown with Mitchell. Let's see if he's as good as he says.
Yes.
Don't go away. Welcome back. I'm still here with Steven Tyler and Joe Perry, and we've got music still to come from Emily Sandé, so stick around. Guys, I didn't know the guys hadn't seen the album yet. This is the new album. It's out November the 5th, and that's you hadn't it. Seen the Steve or the artwork.
We had not seen the artwork. You know, I was in a deli after a couple of the sessions in L.A., recording this album, and someone in there showed me a picture that Slash had drawn of Aerosmith when he was like 13.
So he was a fan.
He was a big, big fan, and I said, "Can I buy that?" He wouldn't sell it, and but we used it on the album. So
that's
there
by
it is.
Slash from Guns N' Roses, or ex
Slash from Guns N' Roses
when he was a kid.
Yeah, yeah. Great little story.
Now, are you guys touring again? Are you going back on the road with this?
We are in 2 months.
Okay. Without wishing to seem, you know, odd about this, but you're kind of, obviously, we're all getting older. Mm. You're 62 and 64 now, is that right? And you look incredible for those ages. I think everyone would agree. I mean, for, incredible. But what's it going to be like touring at this age? It's going to be a different experience when you were first young guys on the road, I guess. What kind of, I mean, do you have to nap, or what do you do to keep...
Actually, he does that a lot.
I love a nap.
I don't know how to do that yet. You know, go to the gym and so forth and just work out, but, you know, I live vicariously through the audience, you know, and they just kick my ass after 2 weeks on tour and I'm 12 again. I mean, just in every essence of the word, it's like, you know, I'm mentally 6 as it is anyway. So I grow up a little and I revert back to, you know, it's just this good exercise. It's the best. I lose 4 pounds a night and it's just...
And what do you eat? I guess you have to look after your body more than you...
Horse shit and splinters. Boiled owl and oatmeal.
Well, you know what I love about Aerosmith? If you don't, I'm going to tell you. You know what you're getting with Aerosmith. You know what you're getting with an Aerosmith album. You know you're going to get... It's going to be classic, kind of big, beefy rock and roll.
I wish I had that kind of confidence.
Big, soaring vocals, you know, and you've still got it, which is remarkable.
Mm.
But the tunes you write are great. And there's something about... you know it's an Aerosmith song as soon as it starts. It's almost... Is there a formula? How do you get that together? What do you look for in each other's writing for that?
Well, it starts with a lick, you know. If he's got something up his sleeve, and I just lay down on it, and then we think about what that's going to be like to play live. You know, what would do to the audience, and how we've always felt as though we were the fire that people danced around, and we might as well write songs that would fuel that. It's just, it's really quite simple, and more often than not, I'm singing something in the stratosphere, and he'll say, remember, we got to play this every night for the next 10 years.
And we know, you know, we've got to bring this out in front and entertain an audience, and that's, again, we come from that era where that was it. I mean, you went out there and you either did it or you didn't, and so it all comes from the rhythm.
Let's have a look. This is the new single from Aerosmith. I don't know if it's been seen. Is it What Could Have Been Love? What Could Have Been Love. Have a look at this. It's Aerosmith immediately.
I close my eyes and see you lie in my bed, and I'm still could have been.
like a classic rock single already.
It's a great chorus, man. Wow. When it hits and bangs into that chorus, it's like, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, God.
Yeah.
Are you going to bring the tour over here? Do you think that you will do the UK again?
Hopefully next year.
Yeah.
So next year.
That's the plan.
And all you guys have still got going on. I don't know if you saw the pictures of the Rolling Stones recently, but it looks like Bill Wyman's been kidnapped and replaced by someone's nan.
He still plays great, though.
I bet he still plays great. Well, he's not in the band anymore. He doesn't have to. Yeah. And that brings me to a question. I'm hoping, I mean, I'm guessing you're just going to keep on going, but do you have a kind of game plan? Do you have a kind of year when you think, OK, we're going to stop then, or...?
No, there's no finish line with us, and we made a vow to be the last band standing.
But it's great. You've still got the rock look going on. You know, convincingly, you're still getting away with it.
Come on, we've been working at it for so long. We're going to change it, change now. I mean, come on.
Okay, I've loved having you on the show. I'm just a huge fan of your work, and it's great to meet you guys as well. Before you go, though, are you up for this table tennis challenge?
So up.
Okay, let's bring the table tennis out here right now. But first, let's say thank you to Stephen Tyler and Joe Perry, ladies and gentlemen. The last band standing. Okay.
Thanks.
David, are you ready for this?
Yep.
I think he is.
Come on.
Okay, will you welcome back out? I'm going to ask Bradley to come out and David Mitchell. Come on out, guys. Let's see what skills you've got on the table tennis court. Choose your weapon, gentlemen. You're going to play with the red or the black side? Joe, you're not playing.
All right, I'll give it a try.
Come on, you can do it. David. Okay, who wants what side? What side do you want to be on?
It doesn't matter to me.
Thank you.
Okay. Are we doing doubles?
You know what I think? Actually, I think it's David against all of us, one at a time.
Yeah.
Okay.
I haven't presented myself as particularly good.
Well,
I just made the mistake of beating you
several times. You beat everyone that night. Okay. So, do you want to have a little warm up first, guys?
A little warm up.
Right. Okay, just a gentle warm up.
Nice.
Wow. Wow. He saved you then. Okay.
Nice.
Oh.
Well, but I've never seen this double-handed thing.
Bloody hell.
Wow. You're out. Joe.
Randy Shore did the same thing to me once.
Do you want to serve or you want to be served too? He's going to serve. Joe's serving. Okay. I think Joe's got some hidden depths here. Oh, well, maybe not. Okay, Bradley. Let's see it.
All right.
Okay. Right, good, nice. Cut it off. Yeah, he's warmed up now, I think. I think you've got a challenge. Yes. Oh!
Yes!
Wow, come on! That's pretty good. That's really good right there.
Yes!
That was exciting.
Booyah! Come on! That's great. Oh, my God.
Come Mitchell. On.
Mitchell.
Me. Okay, I think David Mitchell is our champion this evening. But join me in saying congratulations to the ping pong stars of tomorrow. That was a good move at the end of it.
All right, thanks to all my guests tonight. Tune in next week. I'll be joined by comedian Russell Howard, Action Man Bear Grylls, and the Queen of Pop, Kylie Minogue, will be parking her pert buttocks just over there. There'll also be live music from the mighty Muse. But now, to finish the show, singing the fantastic Wonder, here is Naughty Boy with Emily Sunday.